Everyone, welcome you all in this session. Myself, Assistant Professor Ripa Gupta from LG School of Law. So today we'll discuss the subject of administrative law, and in which the topic of discussion is legislative control. Now, what is legislative control? We have discussed about the delegation of power of legislatures. We have studied the delegation, constitutionality of delegated legislation, and different powers of legislative authority. Now, when the legislature delegate the power to the executive, they have the power to control them too. So that is about the legislative control. How much or when they can control the delegation, their delegation power on the executives. This is all about the legislative control. So we'll discuss how the legislative can control their power that they have delegated to the executive authorities. Now, in parliamentary democracy, we have seen that there are three wings who have divided their work, and they work in their own sphere. But we have also seen that legislative authorities can delegate their work. Now, the legislature has a right to make the laws, but they have duty to check upon their agents when they delegate their work to them. To check upon the agents whether they are functioning their work properly or not. So when they are delegating their work to the executives, they have to see that the executives are working properly under their permissible limits and under the constitutionality of the delegated powers. So this power has been given by them from the constitution, that they have power to see that the executive authorities are functioning in proper way. And for that, they have parliamentary control over them in their hands. Now, the executive authorities to whom they have delegated their power, they have the executive authority has responsibility towards the legislative authorities in two stages. In the initial stage, and second is direct or indirect stage. In these stages, they are maybe responsible, or the legislative powers authorities have power to see whether they are proper functioning or not. So in the initial stage, the legislative authorities will see how much power can be delegated to the executive authorities, what is the permissible limits for delegating the power. This is called initial stage, when they have to see that if they are not overriding their powers, or when they are delegating the powers, their power should not be beyond their powers or beyond the constitutionality limits, so that they cannot delegate the substantial power law in the hands of the executives. So this is the initial stage when they are delegating their power. They have to see that how much they are delegating them, in what permissible limits. The second stage is that can be divided into two parts, direct control and indirect control. So in direct control, there are two types of tests. One is test of mandatory, and the second is test of directory. In test of mandatory, there are certain rules where it is defined that the legislature has a power to control over the executive authorities functioning, or their executive execution power. So that it says that it is a mandatory test where their rule includes that power in the hands of legislatures. Second is test of directory, where the legislatures will direct them on how to make the rules on their rule-making power. That is called test of directory. Second is indirect control, and indirect control lies in the hands of parliamentary committees. This committee will see whether these executive authorities are working in proper way or not. So this includes the executive's powers, their functioning power, or their rules are in accordance with the general object of the act or not, whether their rules is infringing the general object of the act. So here they bar the, they can bar the powers of the court. Here they will see whether these rules is according to the general object of the act or not, and then whether that has retrospective effect or not, whether according to the act which effect they have given to their rules. Then whether that see that they safeguards, and they should not destroy the principle of natural justice. Such a rule should not destroy the basic principle of natural justice. And the last is, it should be in consolidated funds of the expenditure. So these are the indirect control over the executive's power, where the parliament committee will see whether they are working accordance with these rules or not. So we have seen the legislative control. Now we'll see the judicial control over the delegated legislation. So again, this delegated legislation is not beyond the powers of the judicial review of the courts. They are under the purview of judicial review, and court has to see whether they are functioning in their limit or not. So judicial control, they have two types of control, where they can see whether they are exceeding their power or not. So one is substantive ultra vires and second is procedural ultra vires. Now we'll see what is ultra vires. Ultra vires means beyond power, beyond prescribed power, that you perform beyond your limits, that is ultra vires. So there is substantive ultra vires. If I want to say, when legislature goes beyond the power, means whenever they make a legislation where they give extreme power in the hands of the executives, it becomes a legislative ultra vires. They cannot delegate the substantial work. The same way, substantive ultra vires, what does it mean in the sense of executive's power? When the executive authorities performs functions beyond their power or exceeds their permissible limit, they are termed as substantial ultra vires. So if they are exceeding their powers defined by the legislative authorities and they exceed that power, it termed as substantive ultra vires. Now we'll see the circumstances when the authorities infringes their substantive ultra vires, or they use their beyond, they exceed their powers. So first circumstances, first is that where parent act is unconstitutional. So when there is main statute, there is a from parent act, when they have received their power, is basically unconstitutional. If that particular powers gives ample power in their hands, or that power exceeds the limits of delegation of work, that is called unconstitutionality of the parent act. So we see the one case over here, Chintalo Rao versus State of Madhya Pradesh. In this act, they have defined that, in the parent act, they have defined that the deputy commissioner has power to control or to prohibit the manufacturing of PV in certain areas or for certain period of time. Now this is again not a right of the executive authorities to prohibit any manufacturing. So here mainly the parent act is unconstitutional, which is infringing the right to trade and business. So this is unconstitutionality of the parent act. So this delegation of power is ultra vires in the nature. Second situation is where the parent act delegates the essential legislative function. As I said previously also, that the legislature cannot delegate the essential legislative function. So when they are delegating the essential legislative function, it is ultra vires to their power. So they cannot delegate the essential lawmaking power. Third situation is where delegation legislation is inconsistent with the parent act. So when there is a power has been assigned to the executive authorities to make the rules, but if they are making rules which are not according with the parent act, then it can be termed as a substantive ultra vires. For example, in the case of Tahir Hussain's district board, the parent act enabled the district board to make bylaws for the maintaining health and safety of the convenience of the inhabitants of the rural people. Here the board make the rules where they prohibit the law of cattle markets of that particular area. So this rule is ultra vires their power. Another situation of substantive ultra vires is when the directive legislation is inconsistent with the general law. General law means land of the law, the land of the principal law. That if they are breaching that principle, then it's called a substantive ultra vires. So in the case of Hindustan Times to the State of UP, the parliament by an act provided pension to working journalists. The state government by executive instruction imposed levy on government advertisement on newspapers and deduct such levy from the pension from the working journalists. So this act of the government is infringing the land of the law of the land. This is their right. So this cannot be taken away by the state government by using their power. So this is ultra vires used by the state government. The next is where delegated legislation is unconstitutional. So when there is a provision made by the executive which are infringing the rights or the constitutionality of any provision, then it declared to be substantial ultra vires. We can see in the case of Air India's Nargesh Mirza. In this case, the Air India Authority make a rules where they said that air hostesses should not we should not become pregnant or consume their pregnancy up to some age. So this was against the rights of ensuring Article 14 and 15. So such procedures made by the authorities are substantive ultra vires. Next is when the delegated decision is arbitrary. Here the Supreme Court said that in the case of Khodai, this territories that this is state of Karnataka, that even the executive authority has to see that their procedures satisfy the test of Article 14 and 15 in their procedures. They should not make such a provision that ultra vires their power as well as increase the fundamental rights of the people. Here, even the arbitrariness adopted by the executive authorities comes under the purview of judicial control. The last substantive ultra vires is where delegated legislation is unreasonable. The case of Indian Express uses Union of India, the Supreme Court say that in no condition the executive authorities can enjoy or can take the substantive legislative powers. So here it is an immunity of the legislative authorities only. They cannot make such a rules and regulation which includes the role of legislative authorities. This can be termed as unreasonable. So they cannot use the essential function of legislative authority. So today we have seen the judicial and legislative control of the delegated legislation, where we have seen the legislative control and we have seen judicial control, in which we have discussed only substantive control or substantive ultra vires of the delegated legislation. The procedural legislation is still we'll discuss in the next lecture. So today we have discussed about where the judiciary as well as parliament has power to control the executive's function when they are delegated them certain works. Thank you.